everyone. Welcome to the Sugar and Crumbs Kitchen. And tonight we've got Kerry Griffiths back. I believe it's your third visit, isn't it, Kerry?
Is it?
Yeah.
Good grief, that's
the third one.
I've lost track.
He's a regular now. How do we like that? So please give us all your thumbs, waves, loves that you're pleased to have Kerry in the kitchen. We're extremely pleased to have him in here. As we are all our guests, we love it when they come to the Sugar and Crumbs Kitchen and share all their ideas with you. Now, Kerry is coming today to show you his new mould, and it is amazing. Wait till you see it. Some of you have seen it already. Some of you already bought it off the website. That's how beautiful it is. He's going to show you lots of tips and techniques, and I'm going to get out of the way, read the feed, okay, and start shouting out questions, and I'll do a few hellos. I do want you to, if he's looking a bit flustered, let me just tell you, he's been in the car since 3 o'clock this afternoon.
12 o'clock.
Sorry, 7 hours. So, yeah, he did bring me early, actually, because he's been in tailbacks, he's been in traffic jams, and he come running through here at 5 to 7, and we've managed to get it all set up. So that's pretty amazing. I've shoved a big doorstep sandwich down him, which he can't eat. So half of it's still over there. So please do be thankful that he's come along. He's made it. I did have to have a little nervous breakdown this morning when he rang me and said, "Carol, get a backup plan in place." I didn't quite hear it. And I said, "What did you say, Kerry?" He said, "Get a backup plan in place." I wasn't quite sure what that was going to be, but I was running around.
Yes, and I was like, "Carol, I am not sure, unless you can send the helicopter for me, that
exactly.
This is going to happen." So, we really need
a backup plan. So anyhow, I don't need that. Fabulous demo tonight. Make sure you let him know that you appreciate he's going to be here. Everything is on the website. It's on the wish list. So you go to www.sugarandcrumbs.co.uk. At the top, you've got Facebook Live. Wish list, drop down to Kerry Griffiths, and everything he's using tonight is there, and everything that's new to the Sugar and Crumbs shop is in there as well. Okay, and Kerry's going to use some dust, but I put all the colours in because you know sometimes we want to have different colour dust.
There's a good range as well.
Yeah, it's a fantastic range.
I like the range of colours.
Yeah, so we'll catch up with you shortly. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Leave you to it.
Okay. This is my cup of tea. I've only drunk that much, so that tells me how much rushing and prepping I've done. I'll apologise now if I seem a little bit disorganised. You're used to seeing OCD Kerry in a big way. Flew up those stairs, so bear with me if I look a little, oh my gosh, where have I put it? That'll explain it, right. I'm going to take copious amounts of tea as I go along. Right, okay, let's start from the very top. And yes, me being list man, I have lists as normal. So, first of all, let's put that over there because you're going to see it. The new moulds. Continuous quilting mould, mini continuous quilting mould. They are sold separately, and later on Carol will tell you what the prices are. And I do believe Carol may have a special on them if you buy them as two. Again, that's Carol's business. She will tell you about as you go along. When I actually designed these, I wanted to think more commercially. As you all know, I'm a commercial cake decorator. I need to make it easy, I need to make it quick, and I need it to have the wow factor. And I thought, right, so this took quite, it's a simple looking mould, but to be honest with you, geometrically my little drawing box went nuts when I did it, because I had to work out all the different angles for different shapes and sizes. So what I have done, if you look at the mould as it is, a rectangle. Let's talk about different size cakes. If we have a 3-inch deep cake, now, is that the right way up for you, or is it upside down?
It's upside down.
There you go. See, nobody told me.
Thank you.
So, a 3-inch cake looks like this. A 4-inch cake fits into it as well. So obviously you trim the top and bottom off to be the height of your cake. However, if you turn it around, you've then got a 5-inch height, and you've got a 6-inch height. If you need bigger than 6-inch, make another piece of paste and add it to the top. Add it to the side, add it to the side, add it to the bottom. And that's the joy of this. This is why it's called a continuous quilting mould. Now, I did have a couple of questions from the last time I showed this. Where can you put it on a cake? You can put it around the side of a cake. You can put it on top of a cake. If it's a round or an oval or an odd-shaped cake, you're going to have to put the side and the top on separately and then do some sort of border around the top edge. But as you know with quilted wedding cakes, you would have to do the side and do the top separately anyway, because it's really hard to get those angles to work across the top. However, someone did challenge me in the week and said, can you do it on a square or a cube, go all the way over the top?
And you can.
And you can.
It's a beauty.
So I'm going to show this camera because I can't see what the camera's in. So as you can see, I did a cube. So obviously a cube is a square. I reckon you could do a rectangle as well with this. The only thing you need to remember is I did share a little video and I'll show you when we do it. You have to get the corners right. Okay, so if you can remind me that later, Caroline, I'll explain what I mean. But if
you're really expecting me to remember?
Of course, I'm not going to remember. I'm too old. Anyway, there is. If you followed me on my feed, you will see, and I think I did share it through most people. There's this little tiny technique that will make you do it all over the top of squares. So, can you imagine Christmas time? How about doing quilted presents?
Good. And I was just going to say, for everyone who's got the DK applicator,
this is the
perfect mold.
Yeah, absolutely perfect match.
So all of you, so many of you bought that DK applicator, you are going to love this mold.
Yeah, and I'll be using it later on, only because Gwen's threatened me. No, she didn't in the slightest. Hi, Gwen. I know you're out there. You told me you were going to watch.
She's watching.
Yay! Right, where are we up to? Let me go down this list. I want to make sure I've got everything done. Okay. I want to get all of the verbal out of the way before I show you things, because then I'll forget them otherwise. So I've talked about you can cover any size cake or board. So say you're doing a commercial cake, let's cover the whole thing. Say you're doing a display piece at the NEC, Cake International, and you've got figures, why not give them a red velvet cushion to stand upon? It's that easy to use. I've talked about different heights of cakes you can use. If you look at the squares from point to point are 1 inch. But what I've done is I've made sure all of the creases in the quilting are lined up. So these are actually in half inch increments. So if I want to cut a straight line for the bottom of my cake, I can. If I want to change it from a diamond to a square, I can cut along the ridges here. So what I've done is I've made it easy. And as you'll see later, I use a peach wheeler for everything. So that's one of the add-ins for that. Done that. Ultra flexible people, you're not going to destroy a KTC design mold. It's dishwasher safe, you can put ice malt in it. I have the ice malt at the moment because that was one of my things. I actually wanted to put ice malt in and then take it out and bend it round so I could actually make an edible flower vase for the top of a cake or vase. Did you say vase or vase?
Vase,
you're like me, you're posh. So I know you could do that. Or just imagine if you did those and you did the ice malt, you dried them in curves, and then you put fairy lights behind them. How amazing would that look?
Yeah.
I haven't done it yet, but you know someone's going to, because I can absolutely assure you they're
going to. Just to let everybody know, if those who are familiar with Katie Sue molds, this is the biggest mold they've done, isn't it?
Yes, I made them break the mold, literally.
This is not their standard map size mold. This is a deeper mold and a bigger mold, which is fantastic.
And there was lots of discussions about this, Carol, too, because I found that the 4-inch square that Katie Sue do are perfect for cupcakes, perfect for cookies, but for me I wanted something bigger, and we discussed and went, yes, you know, there is a need in the market, which is why I went, right, let's go big. So you never know, you might see more people from me in the future.
They're very excited.
Okay, a couple of very last minute things you need to do. Okay, I experimented with paste, as many brands as I could get my hands on. Will regular sugar paste or fondant go into this mold and come out cleanly? Probably not if it's a sticky or a soft paste. If it's a bit firmer, then yes, it would. However, what I did is I was using Renshaw's, to be honest with you, when I tested this one the last time. And I found if I put 1 gram of Tylose powder, and I do know that you've got,
Rainbow Dust
Tylose powder. I know you've got on the website here. If you use 1 gram of that to 250 grams of sugar paste or fondant, I found that was perfectly good and it came out every time. You just want to get rid of the stickiness of it, and also wanted to make sure it was robust enough so I can pick it up and move it around. So that was the recipe for that. Now, you could just go ahead and put any amount of paste you want into these, but I found it was easier, as I will demonstrate in a moment. I have found that if I use 170 grams of paste and roll it out to fit into this mold, that will give you a finished piece of about 110, because you'll see I clean off the edges. This one is about 75 grams of paste. So let's just shut me up and get on and show you some of these, okay?
So let me just shout out, guys. There's lots of you here, so I'm gonna say a few hellos. The screen hasn't frozen, and if yours has frozen, just log out, come back in again and refresh. Can we put that forward, because it's quite a long way. So just a few hellos. Hello, Lindsay Pearson, Maloney Graham, Pelvy, Martin Dursley. Pelvy, I'm not saying your surname because I can't say it. That's the only reason why.
That's the trouble with international, isn't it?
Mahajan. There you go.
See, I always tell people I can't speak any English.
So hello to Diane Farah, Kate Grant, Linda Chapman, Donna Ryan. Hello, Donna's from America. Julianne Barrett, Jacqueline Penfold, Lisa Marie, Daniel Davis. Oh my God, that's a massive one. Annalise, Rob Allen, Gwen Powell, Julie Brownhill, Karen Place, Deborah Jones. Loads of you. There's absolutely, you've got over 200 watching. Which is fantastic, yeah. So there's 200 constantly watching at the moment, so well done. So I'm going to let Kerry get back on because I've just remembered I forgot the pearls, so I'm going to run off and get the pearls.
No!
They're next door.
Oh, good, that's fine. Okay, if I keep dashing off screen, guys, it's because I prepped so much for you, we couldn't get it all onto one table. So if I keep disappearing over here, it's not because I'm eating the doorstep of a sandwich, which is absolutely delicious and tempting, it's because that's where I put everything. So, right, what I'm doing, I would recommend weighing everything, so, or you need this up the other way, don't you? So this is digital scale time for me. And I'm using 170 grams of paste. It's as near as I can get it. I'm not going to kill myself if it's 170. Oh, wow, that was good. Okay, it has to be 170, guys. If I can do it, you can do it too. So put that to one side. I tend to, if I'm doing a lot of these, I will actually weigh out lots of balls of 170 grams and put them in a bag. So then all I'm doing is I don't have to sit around weighing each one. Each of them is already pre-weighed for me, so it's a bit of production line. So let's put that to one side. Now, as far as prepping my mold, a lot of you are probably used to reaching for cornstarch or cornflour. I tend to use just a little bit of white vegetable fat, and I'm talking a little tiny bit of white vegetable fat. Now, all I want to do is just make sure that it releases. Now, because KTC design molds are actually food safe and flexible and made in Britain, guys, and designed in Britain by me. Well, actually, they're designed in Wales, but they're made in England. So they're technicalities every time. I just put the merest smear on there because I find that actually releases a little easier. And also, if I'm using any sort of luster dust on it, if I've got a coating of white vegetable fat, the luster dust is more likely to adhere or stick to that surface when it's got a thin film of fat on it. One thing I would say though is, in Britain I tend to use Trex, which is a brand for white vegetable fat. In America I use Crisco, which again is a white vegetable fat. I would say though, you are using a food product in a food mold, but after you've done them, give them a bit of a soapy wash, because otherwise you could find it might become a little bit rancid if you leave it in a box. Also, if you're using Crisco, because of the type of white, type of vegetable fats they use, sometimes you get a yellowing in them, or you get like a waxy residue that you'll find a few weeks down the line if you haven't washed your mold, but they're dishwasher safe anyway. So there you go, so we put that. I'm gonna roll this piece of paste into a log. Okay, almost as long as my mold is. Now, I've got a crease down my mold and I've got a non-creased. I want to put the crease upwards just so that I make sure that it's not getting transferred into the bottom. Now, I haven't put any cornstarch or cornflour on my board. If it's sticky, you can just do a little bit. So don't think you're avoiding it totally. It's just a little bit. So, now, this is the reason that I actually weighed it out, because I want to roll out a rectangle that's almost the size of the cavity of the mold, just because it makes it easier. The thing you're going to struggle with anything, is try to keep the corners as square as you possibly can. Dear, it's really funny. Carol is trying to ever so quietly lift down squeaky bottles of water in a plastic container. Sorry. Carol, just give up and pull the thing down, for goodness sake.
Sorry.
So that's not quite right.
Well, I thought it was going to cool down because of the rain, but we only have 6 drops of rain.
Yeah, we had 6 drops of rain in 2 weeks.
I don't know what else got.
So, as you can see, that's almost the right size. Now, the thing to remember, thank you very much, by the way, is to make sure you ease the paste out so it actually almost goes to the corners. Okay, now at this point I haven't pressed anything down. I've literally rolled it out so it's roughly the rectangular size. Now this was 170 grams of paste. When I'm finished, I will have taken off the excess. It will turn into about 110, 120 grams of base. So obviously if you're scaling up or you're trying to work out how much you need for a cake, I would say try and work around 120 grams for a panel, and then you can do the costings on your cake. So I'm using a little bit of corn flour, corn starch in the middle, purely because it's hotter than Hades today and everything's sticky, including me.
Well, now, we can put the aircon on.
Oh no, I don't want that rattling in the background. I'm shouting enough as it is. So I'm gonna press my fingers down, and what I'm doing is I'm anchoring the paste into the mold, because I don't want any double impressions and I don't want it moving around. Once I've done that, I'm going to come along here and I'm going to push it into those diamonds which are the edges. Now if you have bits where they're not quite reaching, you can always backfill, as I call it, and push it towards it. You'll find if you're going to have any trouble areas, it's going to be the corners here, because no one seems to be able to roll out a perfect rectangle, including me. So let's work that all out. Again, rob Peter to pay Paul here.
April's just asking, Kerry, would Karen Davies' paste be okay? And it would.
Yeah, I believe it would. I absolutely believe it would. It needs to be a paste that's not going to be sticking, it's got a bit of firmness to it. Mm-hmm. So yes, if you use Karen Davies' paste, I'm sure Karen Davies' paste will work in these without adding any extra tireless powder. Now, as you can see, I can no longer see the edges of my mould, so I'm going to take this part of my thumb and I'm going to push down and swipe off all the way around. Now this is where you needed that little bit of excess paste, because this pushing action is actually giving me a bit of a sharper edge. Now I'm going to have to go up and do a bit of housekeeping around this just to make sure it's tidied anyway, because that's just the nature of the beast. I've set the dogs off, Carol!
I think they're excited. There might be a second drop of rain, Kerry.
Who let the dogs out? Oh, God, I'm showing my age, aren't I? Really? Okay, ignore you just saw me do that, people. It's heat. You know when you're not supposed to leave your dog in the car? They left me in the car too long. So, as you can see, you do end up with a bit of spare paste, which is good. You can always use spare paste. I just put it back into the mother load. There it is. Now, around the edges of the mould, just come in and just give it a little bit of a press, so you're cleaning up those edges. You'll see that I'm using my finger to support the main body of the paste all the way around. Now there's one thing I need to warn here. When I'm pressing down to clean the mold, I'm pressing down on this bit here and cleaning outwards. If you press down on this piece here, what you're going to find is you're going to thin that bit of quilting down. The sandwich is fighting back. So just make sure you press on the mould and not on the cavity. Okay, I'm going to quickly rush around the edge of this. So, just because you don't need to see me do this, but I need to show you that it needs to be done. Now, if you are someone who's working in a bakery and you're working on a production line system, if you were to cut yourself out a cardboard template the size of the mould, you could then put paste through a sheeter, cut the rectangle out and then lay it directly on, and you would be a lot faster. But for those who are enthusiasts or home bakers, this is probably your best way of doing it. So now I've done that, I'm just going to pick this up, flip it over, peel it back, and it's done. How fast is that?
Fantastic.
And the reason why I wanted a bit of Tylose in is I can now pick this up. Now I could put this in a plastic bag, and I have tested them. I can leave them for up to an hour in a plastic bag. So I can make a few, let them firm up slightly, and they're still malleable enough for me to actually move around. So.
You've got an audience of over 300 now.
Hello, 300, isn't that moving?
Mm, fantastic.
The 300, it is the 300. Sorry, I need a glug of water, seriously.
Absolutely. So just in case anybody's watching, with the sugar paste that Kerry's using, he's put Tylose in. Yep. Because April asked about Karen Davies, you don't need the Tylose, it's already in there. Be fine.
And it could be that there are firmer pastes on the market,
yes,
that you may not need it,
yeah,
with.
Exactly.
I just know I have radiators, yeah, for hands. And I mean, also this paste has been in the car for 7 hours, and believe,
yeah,
me, it's almost cooked anything I had in that car. So now, a couple of joys of this is I'm going to show you another piece in a minute. Are you getting naked on me?
Yes,
it's very distracting. Maybe just taking clothes off in the corner.
If she can change who, she's doing well, isn't she?
There you go. So if you look at this moulded piece, now I do get questions of how does it exactly match around the back of a cake. there is enough design give so you can scrunch it a little or stretch it a little. That will enable you to have a perfect join. So here's the secret to the continuous quilting mat. So this is one I did probably 15 minutes earlier because I didn't arrive that early. Let's take this one out the bag. So, put them together. Perfect match.
Beautiful.
So, and that's the secret of it. And it works exactly the same principle with the small one as well. So, let's take you to another thing and show you what else we need to do with this. Let's pop that one back in the bag because I'm going to use that on the next cake. Yay!
Yeah. I'm amazed Maria stuck some clothes on. You know this heat wave? She's the only girl I know who's been wearing winter woolly tights.
Well, I hate to tell you this, and hopefully Mum's not watching. Mum's had a hot water bottle. Dear Lord, woman, I'm melting and you've got a bottle.
Yeah.
Okay, so what I've done is...
She's had winter jumpers and everything.
Yeah. So I'm going to put this here a second just so I can pick it up. Now, I've already put one around the cake. Okay. There you go. Have a look. Now, you will always have to marry up the top edge, okay? I did this quickly, I didn't do it properly. You can just slide it up slightly and it will come to the top edge of the cake. In a perfect world, I'd like it to be flush, but as I said, I threw this on here. But then, who says I'm not going to have a rope, or maybe I do a drizzle down it as well? I mean, there are so many different things I can do. But what do I need to do next now?
So, question. Carol Place says, when you do two pieces, do you put them together with glue or water?
I'm going to use glue here, but that's a very good point. It depends on what your cake is covered with. Now, I'm working on a dummy, obviously, that's covered in sugar paste or fondant. In a real world, I don't actually need a coating on the side of the cake because I made the moulded piece 3 to 5 mils deep. So therefore, you could have a skim of buttercream and attach it directly to the buttercream.
Can you put it straight on the buttercream?
You could have a ganached cake, brush the ganache with a little bit of water or spritz it, and then stick it directly onto there.
Fantastic.
So there are other ways of doing it. It's like the mould can be used with chocolate, although remember, when chocolate comes out of a silicone mould, it's never going to be shiny. It's always going to have a matte finish. But you know what?
You can always airbrush it.
And you can always use the luster sprays on them.
Yes.
Also, you could use modelling chocolate in this. You could isomalt in this. Now, I haven't done this yet, people, so don't come killing me on this one. There is no reason why I couldn't spread buttercream into this, freeze it, and then pop it out. I don't think you'd be able to pop it out and bend it around a cake. Mm-hmm. Haven't practiced it yet. But you could definitely put it on a top surface and make cutouts of it.
Yeah, you just leave it soften for a few minutes.
Yeah, just...
It'll take a few minutes.
Yeah. So there you go. Just know that there are things that are up here that I haven't got to here yet. So, right, now the thing is I need to work out what size cake is. My cake is a 4-inch deep cake. Okay? So let's pop you out of the way so I'm not in Maria's way. So what I do is, I know that this fits within my moulded piece. I also know that I need to cut along one of these lines. So as I said, I wield a pizza wheel all of the time. Now I just follow the lines along here. They're there as markers to help you. So that gives me my bottom edge of my piece. Now, I know that my cake is 4 inches tall. I wouldn't say go up one, because if you go up one, you're going to be trying to squish it down. But there is actually a mark just there. If I take this mark off, I just know that when I attach it to the cake, I just have to give it a little bit of an upward stretch. Let's take that out. So that gives me my strip of paste. So.
Tracy Hannaford says, can you use it to make a cushion cake? Of course.
You certainly can. You can. And remind me, I'll show you the handbag in a minute too, because that's another one you can actually use. I'm melting here. So, we're in the tropics, people. It's hot, hot, hot.
Do you want me to put this air conditioner?
No, I'm fine. Believe me, the air con, I'd still be perspirating.
Right.
So, okay, so let's bring in the cake now. So, I've already got one piece on here because I wanted to show you how flawlessly they join up. Now, because I'm using sugar paste or fondant here, I'm using a bit of edible glue. You could, I believe, use, you could use piping gel. I don't ever use piping gel to stick things together. I know Americans do, I don't. If this was fresh sugar paste, which it pretty much is, you could use a little bit of water on it. It doesn't need to be edible glue. It's just because I want to make sure it really does stick, it's edible glue. So I come in. it's easier to glue the cake than it is to glue the piece. Because if you glue the piece of paste you're going to stick on, you've then got to pick it up, and what you'll end up with is sticky fingerprints all over the place. Now, I've probably not gone far enough around, but that's fine because I can always attach the other edge. Right, remember guys, I'm doing this upwards, upside down and backwards, so where am I going? That way. So hopefully I can do this with you seeing it.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, we've got a good angle there.
Right, let's just marry that up. Now, first thing I want to do is come back and make sure, give a little bit of a nudge with my fingertips that it's in place. The next thing I want to do, sorry Maria, is I'm going to pick up sugar paste smoother and just make sure that the bottom edge is flush against the bottom of the cake. And as you see, I can just give this ever such a slight stretch and it'll come up to the top edge of my cake. So, as you can see, pretty flawless. And the joy of doing the cake and not the glue on the paste is because then your finger's not sticky. Now, if you do have an area where you miss with the glue, easy, just run the brush underneath it, voila, and it's done. So that's how I touch it to the side of a cake. And as you can see, just a little bit of manipulation gives you a flawless finish. So that's it, as it comes out the mold, stuck directly to the cake.
Beautiful. Okay.
Are there any questions on that one?
No, we're all right at the moment.
Good.
Yes, no, everybody's very intrigued.
We're moving forwards, not backwards, people. Right, we're going to move these to one side.
So, guys, just to let you know, I've got the mould in stock. I had it in stock since Kerry released it last week. I was one of the lucky ones to get the heads up on it.
You got it before anyone else did,
I did. I was the first to get it. So, that's a pleasure of coming to the Sugar Crumbs Kitchen. So I've done a little discount on them, and if you buy two, I think you save £2 if you buy two of them together, which is the large one and the small one.
Does that sort of kind of cover your P&P? Does it counterbalance the P&P? It certainly deducts the P&P anyway,
yeah,
doesn't it?
Yeah, exactly, yeah. So it reduces the P&P.
That's
good. You have to spend over £40 to get free shipping.
Well, then you've got to order three or four sets, people. Yeah. Okay, let's get on this now. Bye. There's no excuses. Okay. Now, I'm not going to show you how to do the little one, because the little one is exactly the same process. Come on, Maria. Good grief.
You can't come this way, Maria. There's two happy girls sat here.
They were closing. Get rid of this stuff.
You can chase Kerry around the kitchen as much as you like, Maria.
Okay. The small one, or the mini, works in exactly the same way, although I use 75 grams of paste. I'm using exactly the same paste. I wipe a little bit of white vegetable fat, exactly the same process. I put it in there, I've rolled it into a rectangle. One thing you shouldn't do with any of these molds, once you've got your paste in, it's okay to gently roll the rolling pin over the back, just to even it out slightly. If you go in and give it a good old press, you'll get double impressions all the way across it. Don't worry if the back of the paste looks lumpy and bumpy. It'll add to the contours of the texture on the front anyway. So don't worry about that one. Just don't be hefty with the rolling pin, people. So it joins up exactly the same as well. So let's move on. Where's my list of things to do?
So Sandra Hollingsworth, I've seen your message. You'll need to private message me afterwards.
Ooh, if secrets.
No, she's placed an order already today and she now wants to add the two moulds to her order. But we think it's gone. So there's a very good chance, Sandra, we're hot us in our office, you know. There's a very good chance it's already gone, but Laura's going to check. But I need you to private message me. And yes, Rebecca, I thoroughly enjoyed popping over to see the British Sugarcraft Guild on Friday. And apparently they enjoyed my company.
They're fools. They're absolute fools. They've enjoyed my company as well. I don't know why. So, right. The little one is perfect for cookie tops, cupcake tops. If you're making small molded pieces, like I did see somebody, and I think I put it on my Pinterest account, someone actually made a bed in the week with a little model dog on it, and they used this for the headboard, which I thought was really cute. I'd love to see somebody do a throne or chair with this as the quilting as well. You could do little jewellery boxes out of it. Heck, you could just cut a heart-shaped piece out, put a decorative element in the middle, and it's done for you. So we'll talk about dragées in a little while. So now, talking about cookies, how quick is it to finish a cookie? Now, say we've got our quilted wedding cake. and we want to actually carry the theme through to our cake. Let's just take a piece of the quilting, which I've already done, as you've seen, exactly the same process. And yes, I can handle these quite a lot, people. I'm not having a problem with them. Now, I have options when I cut things that are not a circle. I can cut heart. So I have, can you see that one, guys?
Yes,
does that
exactly.
make sense? You have diamonds. Or I can turn it 45 degrees and cut it to have squares. So be aware that you can mix and match these around a bit just to give you a different look. So let me just pop that in.
So just had a lady ask, can you use this mould to cover a cake board?
Yes.
Of course you can. No,
yeah,
no,
yeah, that's a given, yeah.
And how would you go about it?
Basically, I would roll out my pieces. I would then probably give my cake board a little bit of a brush with maybe some damp water, and then piece them all together.
Yeah.
Just be careful when you're trimming the sides that you trim directly down. If you swipe like your pie crusting, you're going to distort them all. We can always push them back
yeah.
together again. The other thing I would say too is check your ribbon depth, because actually, prime example, let me see if I can pull one of these out. Let me see if I can hold it this one. You will see that the dips where the dragees are will be lower than the edge of your ribbon. So just be aware, if you're using this to cover a board, you might actually want to consider putting a little border around the outside, maybe do a rope and then put the ribbon around. I actually don't mind it. I'm quite fine with it, but I know there are some people out there, oh, you can't possibly have the ribbon showing above the paste. Get over it, people. So really, or you could just put an extra disc of paste on the board first and then sit this on top so it actually stands proud, and then just round it with the palm of your hand just to give it a bit of a rounded effect. And we'll look at those samples in a minute, guys, just so you saw a flash of them.
So Darren's asking, where did you get the heart cutter? Now, we do have the same heart cutter, but ours has got a comfort grip on it. So it's made by Wilton, Darren. If you go onto our website, just put in heart cutter, and you'll see there that it's got a red grip on it so that
yeah.
you can hold it.
To be honest, I have no idea where my cutters are from. I have an entire box full of cutters,
yeah.
and I've been collecting them for 40 years. Believe me, I have no idea where some of the cutters have come from. So pop it straight out, so therefore I have my piece. Now, if this was a cookie I was going to be using, I would probably use piping gel on a cookie because it's not as wet. Therefore, it's not going to make my cookie soft. I would put this onto a sugar cookie or a ginger cookie. I could actually say use apricot jam. I could use anything like that to attach it. I just come in and I sit that on the top. Now, whenever you bake a cookie is going to change shape. So make sure all of the edges marry up. So if I've done that, I squish that around a little bit, make sure it's all done and dusted. So we have a finished cookie. Now, if you were having those as part of a favour, that's finished on its own, but you could put a dragée into it. Now, what I found is I couldn't find individual colours, well, so Carol's going to tell me they are out there. I couldn't find them. So I actually had to buy 1mm sprinkles.
Right.
Kerry and his tweezers went insane, really. but I'm sure they're out there. I would probably have picked up a piping tip and piped these dots far faster than I could have done this, but I do appreciate not everyone pipes. So I just wanted to make sure you had enough alternatives. But to be honest with you, do you really need to do anything with it?
No.
Okay, so I could just take... There you go, we've finished the cookie. I mean, it's as simple as that. You could just put a letter on the front, you could put anything. I would pick up the only shell that's broken, wouldn't I? Let's do that again, people. Okay, there you go. One sweet little cookie.
Yeah.
So, and that's just enough sometimes to carry a theme through for a wedding or for an event. Or maybe a birthday party.
Well, Sue Berger says she ordered the small one, but now she's seen the big one, she wants to order the big one.
Well,
that's what I like, the big ones.
Well, the thing is, I mean, I know I sound like I'm really, really doing a sales pitch here, guys, but if you're doing a cake with this, this is identical to it, but 50% smaller. You can do cupcake tops, you can do favours, you could do cookies, and then the theme is carried through with the whole thing. So, which is why, because in origin we weren't going to do a small one. I went, wait, there's cookie people out there. We've got to look after cookies and cupcake people as well. I have tried covering a ball. Don't try covering a ball. I tried covering an egg in the week. I couldn't do it on an egg either. So, but I'm sure someone out there is going to prove me wrong. And please share the results of things you do. I would love to see what you're all doing with them. So let's move those all to one side again. Right, where are we up to? I feel like I've been talking like a steam train. Now, obviously, when you're dealing with a cupcake, I would just choose a cupcake topper cutter the same size. Okay? I've just picked up one from my nest of, because, well, my cupcake shop destroyed in the heat of the car on the way up, so you're not going to see a cupcake from me tonight. Believe me, they look like wonderful flowers, all
it's
the
got
cases.
Peeling cupcakes.
Yeah, they all, yeah. The temperature in that car was ridiculous. So, yeah, we all parked on the motorway, we just opened our doors, we were walking around talking to each other for a couple of hours. There you
did
go.
You end up being parked up there, yeah?
Oh, we were in one place for an hour. Literally, we were all talking to each other. They were sharing bottles of water. I felt sorry for the kids. Mm. So the little baby screaming in the car next to me. I went, but there's nothing you can do. I mean, she covered the windows. We wet towels to keep the baby. Yeah. Well, there's just nothing you do. And you can't leave the car running because then you end up with a flat battery. So we were like, yeah, sad, but there you go. So where are we up to? Sorry, carrying this list and I've totally ignored the list. I've talked about that. Okay, before I launch into the wedding cake I want to have a look at, are there any more questions on any of that?
No, they love all of it. I'm just going to go through them.
Now, just because
Annalise is Gwen's friend. I think Gwen and Annalise are dying for you to show the Drage kiss. They've sent out that many love hearts. They've flooded the feed.
Got it. See, I've got it. I have got it. I trust me, Gwen, I've got it. Right. These are samples of what you can do with the moulds.
Dawn says she's so glad that you got through the jam on the motorway.
Yes. Did you actually see my video going, help get me out of here?
No, I didn't see it. Is that what you've done?
Yes, I did. So hopefully you can see all of these. Basically, this is them as they come out of the mould. Then this is them lustered. As you can see, they look beautiful lustered.
They're lovely, yeah.
They do have an eye. Sorry, I don't know which camera I'm looking at. I said, you're probably changing cameras. I'm going, keep it on your toes.
She's working with you. If you leave them all there, she can see every single one.
Oh, are you okay?
Yeah.
Now, okay, this I've added the different coloured dragees into it. So you see, it does
That's
bring
perfect.
It to life.
Yeah.
I've added three colours because I wanted to show that just the colour changes the complete impact of the way it looks like. Mm-hmm. That's quite bright and garish, but that's really subtle and classy, and that's got a nice pristine finish to it. But 1mm dragees with a pair of tweezers.
Hard work.
I would have picked up a number one piping tip and just piped dots in all of them. But as I said, left to itself with nothing on it, it looks just perfect anyway. This is the larger one with just 4mm dragees in. I use 4mm dragees nearly all of the time, and they're the ones I use in the Drigie Kiss anyway. Although I did have a problem with the Drigie Kiss, and you know why? I picked up the wrong pot of dragees, and they were all different sizes. So lesson to Kerry, pick up the dragees that are all going to be uniform in size, which the Drigie
Kiss... Well, I've got some subs that you can take care of.
Yeah, because I picked up the wrong one, and I was cursing, but you know, it was my fault, not Gwen's. Gwen, my fault, put my hands up. And then what I did with this last one, which is probably my favourite because it's so dramatic, I just took lime green and then I lustered it and then I put black dragees in. And I'm someone who likes colour, so for me I'm like, wow, I love that one. So anyway, magic moment over with. So let's just move all of those to one side. So give me a second to hold on. Now, Carol, were you talking to me about backdrops when I was trapped in traffic?
I was, yeah.
What are you doing with backdrops, just so I get my brain
going? If you didn't make it tonight...
Yeah, I'm feeling
blamed
here
already.
When
you rang me in your panic and said, Carol, get...
Panic? Me? Yeah, I was panicked, people.
When you said, Carol, get something else in place, I thought, right, okay. So I was going to do a live on backdrops and taking photos with a phone, because you can, obviously, if you're a professional photographer, that's different, but most people are at home and they just take photos with their
phone. But the sound of the phone
yeah.
cameras are brilliant,
yeah.
And those backdrops are good. I mean, I've got a little selection of them,
yeah.
And I find I use them very often. Just, I want a quick shot. There's nothing worse than going on someone's website and you see the cat in the background and you can see the tiles in the bathroom. You know, it's like, really, people, take 2 minutes. When you're going to take a picture, look around, and those backdrops are a very good way to put a professional one.
I've got a whole load of beautiful ones over the weekend, and I've added another 4 more today.
Another trick you can do with those backdrops, which is something I do a lot, if I'm traveling on my iPad, I have an app, and please don't ask me what it's called, I'll have to find out, where you can cut out the background and put another background in. I can't remember what it's called. And it's quite a simple one. You use your finger to draw around it, and then you cut it and put a new background on. So what I did is, I got my photographic backgrounds, I photographed them with my iPad, so if I'm on travel, I can actually pop the background in electronically.
And you're getting a bit clever now.
No, but sometimes that's just enough to get something out on a Facebook post. Seriously.
I have enough trouble with these lot based and order online. They're all Laura's best friend.
Oh, really?
They all ring Laura.
Oh, I shouldn't have asked.
April, I sold the backdrops. They've gone online and there's some beautiful ones. There's about 8 on there in various colours. So if you just go to the website, drop down to the shop menu. I've also put them on the wish list as well. So if you go on the wish list, they're there. So I've got some really pretty ones.
Try and pick one or two. Think, have one that's classy and definitely wedding. Have one that's really pretty and fun, which is definitely birthday. Yeah. If you've got one of each, then you can probably cover most things. Yeah. And also look at entire backdrops, because I haven't seen these backdrops.
Mine are the
big
ones.
Some of them have different areas. Yeah. So you could photograph the cake in the top half and then photograph it at the bottom half and actually have a different look. So you might get more than one out. I mean, I haven't seen them, so I apologise for that.
I will tell you, the backdrops that we've got, I've only brought in the large, simply because of what Kerry said there. It's more economical for you to move the backdrop around and use different sections for cupcakes or turn it upside down, and then you can actually use them up to a 4 or 5 tier cake.
Wow.
So I'm going to pop the link on for you guys. So while you're adding to your shopping basket, you might all treat yourself to a backdrop.
And I hate to say it, Christmas ain't that far away, people.
No, I know, it's far away.
I'm scared of that, but it's not that far away. Right, I'm just doing one of these pieces while I'm talking because I was running late. I didn't get a chance to prep this one and I needed another prepped piece for what I'm about to do. So just going through this again, as you can see, I've rolled out a rough rectangle. Basically, if I can just see the tips of the moulded piece, that's enough for me. I'm just going to put a little bit of cornstarch or corn flour on and then anchor it down. Now, I did have a question the other day when I launched. Would you brush the mould with a luster dust first? Yes, you can, but I actually find it's easy to brush it afterwards because getting luster dust out of a mould, for some reason it doesn't want to get out of a mould. So I tend to, because I'm using a little bit of white vegetable fat, I put it into the mould and then luster afterwards.
Right, well, you've just answered Rita Caddick's question because she said...
God, I'm good.
Yes,
really?
I know
I'm
you
on
answered
it today.
Before I asked you. Look at that. So, do you have to put Trex on or could you put corn flour on the mould?
Yeah, you could put corn flour.
Yeah.
When I was experimenting with the first one, the one thing I found about dusting the mould, first of all, is dust it with cornstarch and then knock the excess out. Because if there's any in there and as you're moving the paste, if the paste pushes together, it will sandwich together the cornstarch and you'll never get rid of that crease. I just know for me, the white vegetable fat worked perfectly well, but then, I mean, use whatever you're comfortable with, seriously. It just happens I've got radiators for hands and for me, this is the best results I could get. So I do have little videos of me doing it again. So if you don't watch this back again, there are definitely videos around of me doing it just because I want to make sure everyone knew exactly what I was doing.
Let me just ask a question because I probably missed it. Which paste did you use today, Kerry?
I use Renshaw's today.
You use Renshaw. Yeah. So Darren, because Darren's asking what colours you've used, but I take it you use different colours of Renshaw's, haven't you?
Yes. One of the reasons I use Renshaw's a lot is because Renshaw's colours are usually quite intense. It does mean that if I've got, say, a block of emerald green, if that's the right colour, it's Kelly green I think it's called, I can probably make 15 or 16 shades of that green just by adding a little nugget of it. And I found with some paste that are not really supermarket paste, the acid balance within the paste means that when you put a colour in, sometimes the colour will fade or change colour within 24 hours. And I found because a lot of the commercial paste made for us cake artists, are balanced. You can colour them, but I found I get better results by using a block or a solid colour and adding that in little bits to white. So I tend to have a larger amount of white and little pieces of colour all over the place. But yes, so everything I've made here
is with Renshaw paste.
Is with Renshaw colours.
And a bit of Tylo.
Yes.
So, in answer to your question, Darren, the Renshaw colour paste have got some beautiful colours. Oh, we do sell a full range of them.
Duck egg blue. And that, is it pastel green?
Yes,
that's
beautiful.
Those are my two ultimate. In fact, I probably use them far too much.
Yeah.
And nearly all my cakes are beginning to look the same.
I must admit, I used the pastel green with Georgie Goldbold a few months ago. And it was lovely, very nice.
And their black as well is really, really black. Yeah. And don't be afraid, guys, you can add another colour to that black to actually
make it grey.
No, to actually, it'll stay black. It's, I mean, if you add a load of white to it, you'll turn grey. But seriously, I've thrown some blue and I've thrown odd bits in. Yeah. It's still because of the intensity of the colour within it. Yeah. It tends to keep its blackness.
Right.
So yeah. Yeah, I do.
Sorry, I meant add a bit of black to white to make it grey.
Oh yeah.
No,
yeah.
I think you'd have to have a lot of white and black.
Yeah,
to
seriously,
make
it grey. Seriously, that is black. That really,
yeah,
really
is
black. So
I popped the link up there for the Renshaw colours, and as Kerry says, the pastel green and the
duck egg blue
are his favourites, and they are very nice. Yeah.
Yeah, I have to sort of step back from those for a little bit because I think I've used them far too much. So, I was just doing the other piece now. I just wanted to show you that as I finished it, quite lumpy, but if I just take my rolling pin and literally that's all I'm pressing. That's just enough to flatten down the back a bit. You don't need it perfectly flat. You go in and roll it and you'll give yourself double impressions. So let's just peel that back. As you can see, it comes out really, really easy and it is flexible. So I just want to put that into the bag with the other one. Oh, no, I don't. There's the bag. I thought I'd mislaid my bags. Now, if you're preparing them in advance, because of course I could prepare all of these, keep them in bags, and then while my cake is chilling, I can be putting these in bags, and then when the cake comes out the chiller, I can work with them already done. I tend to go in and just put a little bit of cornstarch on the bag before I pick up my paste and slide it in. Only because I don't want it sticking in anyway. Oh, I folded over the end. Silly Kerry. Now, when you come to the back of the cake, don't forget you can cut individual squares and slot those in because they're all geometrically measured, they will all fit together. So let's put that over there. So now we're going to move on to the wedding cake I wanted to do, and I wanted to do something with a bit of theme. So I'm going to look at those in a moment and show you how I put them on. But there's a couple of other molds I am using today. Please don't ask me to name them because my brain has gone dead on this.
Well, they're all Katie Sue molds.
They're all Katie Sue because I use them a lot, obviously.
Yeah.
This one I love, it's the Driftwood, it's Dreams.
And it's the Stones, isn't it?
It's Stones, it's got, I mean...
Oh, I'll get you the name in a second.
Yeah, because I'm struggling with the name there. But okay. I mean, as you can see, you get beautiful detailed pieces out of them. That's just a marbled paste. That's the seashells, I believe, and that's the seahorse.
Yeah.
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do one of the shells, I'm going to do one of the seahorses. I've already done them, however, just for speed so I can get them all done and dusted in time. But I just wanted to show you which ones I was using. So let's move that to one side. Where's that brush gone? Brush. There you go. Now, when it comes to a mould this size, let me get me a bit of colour actually. Here's my colour. I think Maria scared me, people. She's running in the opposite direction. Now, when you're using these moulds, because they're a larger cavity, you can use a bit of cornstarch.
You're using Dream, Driftwood and Wordstones. That's one mould altogether.
Yeah.
And you're using the fish, seaweed and coral, I think it is. Is it?
No, I'm using the seashells.
Seashells, sorry, and the seahorses, yes.
The seaweed one is gorgeous. It's just I thought I'm going to have too much on this cake. But the seaweed one goes perfectly with the seashells. Got this fish in it. So as you can see, I've just dusted that and I've brushed it out with a soft brush. You don't need to use white vegetable fat on this, although you can if you choose. And then all I do is I take a piece of paste. Now, this is the paste that I was using for the quilting. If you were to look at the videos of me doing it, you can, if you want them to dry firm, use about 5 grams to about 500 grams of paste. So 5 grams of tylo to 500 grams of sugar paste or fondant. But it depends on what your paste is to start with. It also depends on your ambient temperature where you live. So find a paste that's quite firm, that's not gonna stick. I come in and then I push it. As you can see, it's coming out the mold quite easily. I work it down into the mold, I work it along, and I use my thumb to swipe off the excess. I just come in and I make sure I've got it all pressed down. Now, if you find you don't get a good impression the first time, the joy of it is, I now have the right amount of paste. So I could always take it out, roll it back into a bean, and then it's ready. So there you go. How quick was that? Now, once these are dried, you could quite easily go in and paint up the cavity inside. It's quite deep, which means you can go in there with a brush of maybe gold or silver, or in this case, it could go in with a chocolate colour or maybe a nice emerald colour to paint up the detail there. So that's a beautiful way to do that. So, all right, let's have a little... I'm making you nervous, aren't I? Carol, I think that Maria's scared of me.
Yeah. So, you're bigger than her.
Now, whenever I've got spare paste, I always turn it into something. You know, you always have those little bits at the end of a project, you're like, what am I going to do with that? I turn them into something and I let them dry and I put them into a box. So here I am, I'm just taking two different colours and just roughly marbling them together. Okay, I'm not doing a lot of work, I want them to be quite patchy. I'm going to come in, I'm going to dust them with a bit of cornstarch or corn flour, tap out the excess, and I'm going to work this down into the mould. Again, thumb swipe the end of it off. Tidy this up.
So I'm just going to quickly tell you, you can clean the moulds by hand washing them, or lay them face down in the dishwasher. And Kaz, you've not missed the quilting. You've missed some of it, but Kerry's doing quilting.
Next. Well, I won't be re-showing how to do it, but I'll be applying it.
Yeah.
So there you go. So don't forget, guys, ultra flexible, just pop it out, seashell, and see the veining comes through and it's really lovely. Now if you were to hit that with a luster dust as well, that would bring out even more detail. So basically, if I've got a whole sledge load of paste left over, this is the sort of thing you end up with. So I have boxes of these. Now it's very important you make a note of what the sell-by dates are on the post. On the paste, I normally put a bit of paper in there saying sell by, just because if I'm doing them for food, I don't want to go past sell by date. So, what's she doing? What's she up to? Oh, she's being sneaky, Carol. Tell her not to be sneaky. Right, let me get another bag of paste out of the way. Where's that blue one? Because I really like the blue one. I think that's probably enough to do it. Okay, move that aside, that aside, that aside. I've lost the seahorses. Okay. Seahorse. Now let's do
it.
No, I've got it. It's me being a bit ditzy. I need a lug of water, people. That's what I need.
Mm-hmm. We'll have a look at your marvellous cakes over there. Should we show them? We've just had a quick... Oh, have you had a quick flip over?
Yeah,
look at that. They're beauty, though, aren't they?
Yeah. Actually, before I do the seahorse, I never showed you the handbag cake.
Yeah, let's bring that over and have a look.
Yeah, I forgot that. Sorry guys, there was the handbag cake. So, and I freely admit,
send it towards Laura. Hi.
Hi, lower, hi, lower.
There, we've got it.
Yay,
stay still.
Handbag cake.
That's beautiful.
And all that is half a circle carved into, I think it's a clutch purse, would it be?
Yeah.
I didn't have time to do a handle. I did a zip.
Yeah.
I did a zip down the middle. So yeah, suddenly really simple. And beautiful. The Drigi kiss came into its own doing this. As you can see, I did that quite quickly and then I just sprayed it to give it a bit of a sheen.
Yeah.
So, there you go.
Beautiful.
So that's that one done. So, where am I up to? So, when it comes to the seahorses, it depends on what your... how the day is... She's touching things, Carol. She's touching things. you can do this two ways. You can use cornstarch and get in there and give it a good dust with a soft brush, or you could use white vegetable fat, your choice. I find I'm more successful at getting the really little pieces out if I wipe it with a little bit of white vegetable fat, because these big fat fingers, it's really hard, but I can get a perfect little seahorse out that way. But if I'm using the bigger ones, I can actually just use cornstarch. So, roll this into, God, this paste is so warm. So I'm going to start at the beginning, I'm going to work my way all the way down. And what I'm doing is I'm feeding the paste in with a rocking motion. So I'm working my fingers back and forth to make sure I get into all of those little nooks and crannies. I find it's easier to work with a tapered piece of paste to start with than to just stick a big blob on the top and expect it to work, because it won't. So I'm working my way down the mould. Now when it comes to the tail, you've got to do a little bit of artistic twisting around to get it in there. Now, I tend to use a plastic knife on moulds, because if you're spending good money on a mould, you certainly don't want to be injuring it with a metal knife. Now, I know the paste is going to move around, but what I'm doing is I'm working my way down to try and get a basic amount of paste in this mould. Fingers again, work down into it, push it down, get into all of that detail, and believe me, this is a beautiful seahorse. All the way down. Now, once you've got it in there, open the mould out a bit, just so you can see around. Now, you're not just seeing around. By moving it, you're actually letting air get underneath it. Now, if you find your paste is too soft and sticky, add a bit more Tylo to it, okay? Because with something like this, you may find if your paste is too soft and stretchy, you're going to struggle. But once you've done that, turn it over. I'm sorry, I don't know how this is going to come out on film. I use my paintbrush. I'll bend this back really severely, and I'll use my paintbrush to peel it down. Now, when it comes to the tail, it's likely to come out. Oh, mine came out perfect for once. Normally, when you take it out, you'll find this stretches all over the place. Just roll it back up and put it back into position. But how beautiful is that as a seahorse?
Beautiful.
I love the seahorses.
I love the colour.
I love the colour. I can't remember which colour. Is that baby blue? No, that's a bit darker than blue.
Is it
blue?
The paste you've used there?
All of this is Renshaw's. I can't remember which one it is. I might have mixed a bit of dust in with it, though. So, you know, it's sneaky.
Their baby blue's a bit darker, isn't it?
Yeah. So, and that's the little one. And then that's the little one if you add luster dust to it. So you can see you get the same amount of detail, absolutely miniaturised. So those are really, really perfect. So if I was actually doing a cookie, say it was an ocean-themed party, I could easily take a cookie, just pop it onto a quilted, and how exquisite does that look? And that's without doing anything to it. And we will be doing things to them afterwards. So, right, let's move you to one side. Now, for those of you who have been following me, I have shared the journey of this cake. So let's bring the cake.
There's a couple of people who've been watching the journey. They said it looked horrendous.
Oh, yeah.
I missed it. I haven't seen any feed pop up today.
Oh, I've done a couple.
I was too busy running around thinking what I was going to do if you didn't turn up.
I was out photographing traffic. I did a little video of help get me out of here at one point. And I was losing the plot because I was... Sorry, I was a bit warm. I was seriously panicking at one point. I'm like, I am never going to get there. I am never going to get there. I got here.
I said to Laura and Maria, right, we're going to start off and Kerry's going to come running in. So
I had visions of that happening, I can absolutely assure you. So what I have in front of me is I have a 12-inch round cake drum. I've got an 8, 6 and a 4, each of them 4 inches deep. I did cover them with sugar paste. I didn't want a sharp edge. I know we all love sharp edges. I didn't want a sharp edge for this, because what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a quilted panel that peels over here and around there, and it's easier if you've got a slightly curved edge. All I did then is I took some airbrush colour, and before I assembled the cake, I airbrushed the bottom part, and then when I put it on, I used the serrated rope mould, which I designed, just to finish it off, because I thought it gave a bit of a sea theme. It just tied it in perfectly for me. So, the next thing I did was I...
Beautiful colours.
I do that. Yeah, someone on Pinterest did a cake very similar to these colours, and I saw them and went, I want to do that. So, whoever you are, because unfortunately I didn't save the picture, and I tried going, I'd give credit to, but I don't know who to give credit to, but you'll find yourself. So, I cut out just a generic shape. What I did is I folded it into 4, a piece of paper, cut out one shape, and then of course I get a symmetrical shape, and I wanted the shape to go from the tier here all the way down to the tier down there. Okay, so that was my aim. Now, when I first cut it, it was too big. You have to play around. Come on, Maria, join us. I needed to play around with the shape and the size, which is why I'm not going to say there's a tape template on the internet. There isn't. Find the one that works best for you, okay? And anything inspirational-wise, play around with it. Don't cut it out of parchment paper or silicone paper. It'll curl up on you. Do it on copier paper or sketch paper or something that you can actually work with, okay? So that's the shape I'm going for. Let's move. You can sit over there a second. So the next thing I wanted to do is I wanted to work with my pieces of paste. Now, if I'm going to pair up two pieces of paste, I want to make sure that it works on the board first. So, and this design does fit on one, but I wanted to show you how to cope if you were pairing two together, because in the real world, probably be pairing two together. So, let's take another one out. So what I'll do is I will pair my paste up. I'll stop folding it over on itself and rip, so that I've actually got the biggest part of the panel I can. Then I can lay that on top. Now, know where the join is. Now, if there's a top and a bottom, I would say make sure that the largest amount is in the bottom. So as you can see, my join is here. And that's because it's easier to add the top bit to it later. So where's my pizza? There it is. So I'm just gonna randomly cut off some shapes just so I can get the excess of this off before I bother working with the piece I want, because goodness knows I don't need to work that hard on it. So now, around the edge of this piece is going to be a piped border. So I don't need to be that perfect with it. And of course, you can use a craft knife. You can do whatever you wish to cut it out. At one point I did have a big oval cutter and I cut it in one big oval. I think I did that on the launch on Monday. So it's whatever you wish it to be, guys. So, cut there and a cut there. Right, just so I've got my general shape. Now, don't worry if it looks rough. That's fine. Doesn't matter that it looks rough. As long as you've got your basic shape there, when it goes on the cake, I'm going to be freehanding a border around this. Any closer, I'll be eating that. So, but I just want to make sure that I've got the basic shapes of this down. So let's take that off right there, because it needs to be a little more evened up. So as you can see, I've got my basic shape. I'm not worried that it's absolutely perfect. It doesn't need to be perfect, because it can be finished off on the cake. Let's take that out of the way. Pop that into one of these. Right. Now I'm gonna have to be working facing that way and then I'll switch it around. So me and Maria, we're friends. So I'm gonna have to pull this in so I can actually see what I'm doing as well. So bring the cake in. Now, know where the front of your cake is. For me, I always put a little bow on the back of my cake board so that I always know where the back of my cake is. It's old school. It's just the way it works for me. So I'm going to turn this around. I'm going to try and do it so that camera can see it for you guys, okay? Now, the first thing I need to do is I need to work out where this middle line is going to sit on my cake, okay? So I know that I want the top of my piece at the top of the cake. So if I line it up so it's just above that line, that's one thing, but I can go in and if I just put a bit of a mark, because the mark's being covered up anyway, it's just enough so I can see where it's gonna go. Now in this instance, I'm gonna do exactly, I've lost my paintbrush, oh, there's another one. I'm gonna do exactly what I told you not to do before. This time I am gonna paste the back of, ooh, I've missed a stage. Stop me. Sorry, I forgot to do something. Let's take this out of the way. I forgot to luster it, and you all want it lustered, don't you?
Yeah.
See? Sorry guys, I told you it wasn't as organized.
It's because we're all excited waiting to see what you're gonna do with it.
It's gonna be a disaster. So I'm gonna put this on my piece of paper. Sorry, I should have chosen another color, shouldn't I, really? But there you go. Now, where are those lovely dusts gone? Where have those dusts gone?
What did we do with them?
Oh, I put them over here.
Yeah.
Right. So I've got a reasonable selection of dusts here. Which ones? Is this a pair of pink? Is that a shimmer?
darker one next to it.
Okay. I tend to use soft brushes when I do any sort of lustering, purely because they get into all the little nooks and crannies. So, but make sure you don't have a heavy amount on your brush to start with. So come in, and I don't mind if it's not even all over. It adds to the style of the cake I'm doing because I want a sort of watery effect when I finish pearlizing it.
It all sort of comes together afterwards,
doesn't it? It does. I mean, I'm tying the colour scheme in, hopefully, with the whole rest of the cake. So, as you can see, I've just added patches of colour. Now, if you've got an airbrush, easy with an airbrush. Mm-hmm. Absolutely easy with an airbrush.
In a couple of weeks' time, they'll have Dawn Butler here with their brand new all singing airbrush.
Great friends with Dawn.
Yeah.
I love Dawn. Where have I put the pearl dust? I have to use this one because I need a wipe now. Can't get the box open. Now I'm going to wipe down here.
Yep, and there's that one, and there's, or do you want white?
A white. A pearl one though. I decanted mine because I travel, I don't bring the whole pot with me. I'll just use this one.
Use that one, yeah.
As I said, I decant mine because I find, because I'm traveling a lot, you carry six or seven of these, or you carry
space.
Six or seven of these.
Yeah.
So, believe me, when your luggage bursts, you don't want lime green all over your clothes. You'll never get it out. So I'm just going to take a bit of the pearl now. And as you can see, the pearl will mute it all down, but give it that beautiful sheen. And this is the joy of when you're using one of these molds, because all of the detail just pops out. And with anything else, the more you brush it, the more the sheen you'll get on it. So, as you can see, that'll look a lot more pink when I pipe the white border around it, I can assure you. Put that down. Now, please do not at any point blow on food. I've got a little camera puffer here, but you can get those little travel bottles with a squeezy hole in it. Puff the dust off, guys. Don't blow it. You're blowing on somebody's food, okay? Really. Just make sure you get all of the dust out. Make sure you get it out of any little holes or crevices, purely because when I start putting glue into them to put the dragees in, I don't need them to fall them out again. Right, there you go. And that's not that, seriously, you can pick that in the camera shop. Or you can actually buy them on the internet to clear keyboards.
Yeah.
But seriously, go to the £1 store
and
buy the travel bottles.
Yeah.
And it's just a little plastic bottle with a hole in the end. I'm just being posh because I take a lot of photographs. So, right, let's move that to one side. So now we can go back to where I was before. So, border's going to need a severe clean later. So bringing my cake back in again. Right, this is sort of the rewind moment, okay? So, now, these are the marks I put in, so I know those marks are where the top of my bottom edge is going to go. I'm going to come in with a bit of edible glue, and I'm going to glue the top edge of it. I'm not going to glue all the way down to there, because when I put it onto the cake, it's going to move, and I don't want that on my cake. Now, unfortunately, I'm going to have to turn this to me to keep it level. As soon as it's stuck in place, I'm using the edge of my hand with like a chopping motion just to embed it into place.
Just let me say, yes, the DK's back in stock, Kaz.
Yay!
Yeah.
And then I'm just going to put a little bit of glue under here just so I know that it's going to stick down. So just embed it all so there's a nice secure place for this to sit. Then I'm going to come in. And I'm going to do the same thing on the top. And then again, sorry, I have to turn it to me to make sure it's straight. Says he with his varifocals, and it probably isn't. So.
It's quite an interesting design you're doing there. What are you doing?
Right. Okay, so once I've got in there, what am I doing? I'm being a professional. So I'm going to put some cornstarch on my fingers now, and I'm going to bevel the edge. Just ever so slightly, because I'm going to be piping a border onto this. So I want to make sure that I haven't got a big honking edge to cover up.
Those pinks look lovely like that, actually.
Yeah, they do, and that's what I said. If you put a deeper colour underneath and then luster white or pink over the top, it just gives all of it a nice bit of dimension.
Yeah, it does.
So it's really important to look at your cake head on when you do this sort of stuff. There you go. So that's put my panel on. Now it should be completely secure, it's supported by the cake and it's attached to the cake, and I'm about to pipe a board around the outside. So let me get to my list and find out what I'm doing. Do you know, I've never been just so disorganized in my life.
I'm impressed you've got a list. We just wing it in here.
No, I can't wing. No, wing doesn't work for me. So, right.
Crikey, we would fall over if we had a list.
As far as working on a real cake, I would never ad lib. I draw a design.
Yeah.
Even if it's rough as old heck, which this one is, but you know, that means something to me. Whatever you can doodle with your hand, you can pipe. Yeah. Now, I'm saying pipe because I wrote a book on piping and I'm known for piping skills, and I'm using raw icing today. However, all of these elements, S's and C's and shells, are actually, they can be molded pieces because I created the molds for those as well. So if you do already have the creative cake system, the initial launch with all the borders in them, then you know what? You've already got all these elements. So don't go, I can't pipe. Who cares? Use a mold. Whatever's easiest. So let's come. Oops, Kerry falls over and breaks his neck. Right, so I'm using raw icing here. The raw icing I'm using today is actually the Squire's Kitchen Premix, which I think you sell it.
Yes, we sell that, yeah.
Yes. Now I'm hoping, I've really stiffened this up because it was getting really warm. I'm hoping I haven't stiffened it up so much.
I was going to say, because you have it in the car, haven't you?
Oh, yeah. This was super when I got out the car.
You was worried about it, weren't you?
Yeah, this nearly went the way the cupcakes went, I can tell you.
So this is Royal Icing. I haven't actually put it on the wish list, but I will do afterwards. So we do two types. We do the Royal Icing by Renshaw, and this is the quick mix that Squires do.
Now, there's another thing too. Don't forget, not because Carol sat opposite me, you can actually make raw icing with the icing and sugar that Carol actually preserved. I'm not a fond person of having flavoured raw icing, there's no reason, because raw icing has a flavour on its own, but I'm sure you could make some amazing flavoured raw icings with the range you've got. I just have never done it. I'm a bit old school, people. Raw icing is sugar and eggs, so... I'm not actually, does your raw icing flavours carry any colour?
No.
Okay, so they would still be white. So.
Unless you use the chocolate ones, obviously.
Yeah, really? I'd be so impressed if a chocolate one was white. So, really?
Well, we've got one white chocolate one.
Oh, okay, now you're getting a bit heady. Right, so I'm using a plastic bag and a coupler because I can. So, yeah, I should be able to use that. So, now... Oh, itchy nose again. I'm using a number 13 piping tip. It's a PME number 13 piping tip. And I need a brush to tidy things up. Come here, brush. Right, and I'm using some damp water on a paintbrush just if I want to tidy up any lines. So now, I have a plan, but if I change halfway through, only I know it's been changed. So I'm going to look directly onto my cake. I'm going to pipe one shell, two shell, three shell. Okay, all I've done is I've started my design off. Now I know I want to do something very similar at the bottom, so I'm gonna do up the shell and then down the shell. Now at this point, I'm so not worried that things are perfect because I know by the time I finish this, there are gonna be things like shells and dragées and pearls and little bits of everything on this. I'm not really worried. The moment you start worrying about stuff, you stop being creative. So I'm going to come in here and put...
Right, those two items are in the wish list now.
What items?
Royal item.
Let's see. So I've started my design off and then I'm immediately going to go for my 13 because I want this to look a little more delicate than it was. And I'm going to go to a 44. Now these are PME piping tips. So basically that's a large star tip and a small star tip. Depending on what brands you're using,
yeah.
Not all numbers run across the...
Let me have a look at that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a small starter.
Yeah, it is.
So.
And the other one is the Wilton 32.
Is it? Okay. I want to say this is the Wilton 364, or it used to be.
I don't know.
But I haven't memorised them. I'm not that good. So I'm going to come in, I'm going to pipe myself. What have I got to see? I always do one side and then do the other side because it's easier for me to get symmetry that way. Now, there's something else you may have noticed. I haven't put the dragees in there yet. Why haven't I done that? Why would I stick a dragee in if I'm going to pipe over the top of it anyway? So always make sure you know exactly what your design is. So once I've done that, I'm going to come in, I'm going to top line this. I'm going to come in, I'm going to add a piece in here. And balance it over here best I can. At the end of the day, I'm not going to kill myself, it's not symmetrical. I just want it to be ornate. I'm creating a picture frame in my quilted area. They're ganging up on me, Carol. There's cameras everywhere. I need head cam, don't I?
She's doing
I need
well, Laura.
One right in the middle of my head. So
yes,
I'm
that's a good idea. Well done, Laura. Just hold on, Kerry. Hold on, we're just changing the camera. And we'll get just Laura's fingers up at you. Are you there?
Yeah.
Are you there?
Yeah. See, they're good, these girls. Laura's contract's due up in August, you see. So we're negotiating a few things, Karen.
Oh, she can get a professional in then.
Yeah, so she's going to be good on this camera action. She's not doing much talking tonight. And then we've got to get her doing baking on lives because she can bake.
Oh, good for you.
And you heard her before when she was telling you she'd been making ice cream. How many flavours has she made earlier?
Yes, you were boasting about ice cream. Where is your flipping ice cream?
Yeah.
Right, I think that'll be okay. Right, now I'm going to just go in and top line these. As I said, I'm not worried about perfect. Because once I've added all of the decorative elements to this, believe me, you're not going to see them.
It all pulls together.
Now, obviously, once this is dry, which is something we're not doing in this live, I could go in and I could paint that gold, or I could paint it silver, I could paint it pearl luster. I mean, I could take it further, but we do only have so many hours in the day.
I have to say, when I was asking you what you was doing with that before, it's now, I can now see what you're doing. It's great, isn't it?
It's one of those things that, the thing is that that's how my mind works, because I know where I'm going with it.
Yeah.
Normally I know where I'm going. So I'm going to set that to one side for a second or two, just to dry off a bit. Or we go back to our seahorse. So, actually, I want to just add a little bit. Now I can see down the side here.
A couple of people like your shirt, Kerry. Where have you got that from?
Oh, God, no, where got this from? I wasn't supposed to be wearing this tonight.
Yeah, I don't know, Nico, when you put your nice chef uniform on, don't you?
Oh, I'm not going to be wearing a shirt. Seriously, you're lucky I'm not in bloody boxer shorts. It's like red horse hot in here.
That would have been interesting in here then, wouldn't it?
Yeah, it's not happening either, I can assure you. So, right.
That would have been a different show altogether.
Completely different show, and yes, we're selling tickets, people. So, right, I just wanted to show you what happens when you add a little bit of luster or colour to the seahorses, just because they're amazing, and I don't think you appreciate how much detail is in one of these till you actually start hitting dust. Pine green is so not the right colour, Griffith. Right. So I'm going to take some of the forget-me-not. Now, again, I tend to use softer brushes for this. So I'm going to come in with this, and I'm going to do the front side of his belly. Now, again, there's no need to be absolutely accurate, people. We're having some fun here. Okay, maybe a little bit of yellow.
I love it that you're doing blue seahorses.
I love blue, it's one of my favourite colours. So.
You're doing well on this job, you Laura, aren't you? A lot of pressure's on tonight,
oh,
eh?
God.
So just to let you know, there's no John in the kitchen. To be fair, both John and I have been in work very early, from six this morning. So is Maria and you, haven't you, Laura?
Well, the truth, John said he's never working with me again.
We're dedicated, us. We've been in since six.
Right, this is pine green. I know it seems an odd colour to put on here, but I want to just put a little bit of dimensional to the back of this wing. Fin, sorry, not wing. What am I doing? So, just a bit of...
Louisa Johnson, you've missed most of it. You'd be best off watching catch-up. There's no way we can explain to you what we've been doing. Always makes me laugh, that.
Louisa, I'm disappointed in you. You promised me. I gave you the time. I said, Greenwich Mean Time, and you've let me down. Sorry, that's that. You've just gone to me. I will never speak to you again.
I'm late, but what are we doing? Really, 1.5 hours later? Just hold on, Kerry, while we repeat it.
Yeah, let me start again. Seriously. Only joking. You're welcome, no matter what time you arrive. Just don't do it again. So.
And Maloney, Maria cannot. Maria Maloney cannot believe you're not wearing a jumper today.
Who, me? Oh no,
Maria.
I've lost
took it off.
Where did I put the white? There you go. So I've got some colour on there. Oh, I can't get my pot out of there.
Is it a proper white one? I've got
snowflake. No, I wanted the same lustre.
Yeah.
So because of course seahorses have a certain shimmer to them. You're underwater.
So Louise says, what are we doing? And Kerry said, April says, Kerry is stripping to his boxes. Oh, the challenge is on now, Kerry.
Yeah. The things you say when
we're after nine now.
There are things I'll do to sell my moles, but there's things I won't do either. So, right. Now, if I had an edible marker, which is another thing I didn't put in the box, I'd give him a little eye, but I haven't.
Oh, I could have brought him in as well.
Yes, I didn't even think till I just did it now.
Yeah.
Oh, there should be an edible marker on there. So, as you can see, difference.
Do you want me to go and get it?
You can do if you want.
Yeah.
Just a blue or a brown or a black.
Yeah,
I'm just going to give a little, just giving a little eye. So there you go. Just shows you how much of a difference it actually makes by adding it. Or you can just come in and using just the one colour. Bring the whole thing, just the detail comes out on it. So you can play around with this. Obviously, if you've got someone with an airbrush, you can do lots and lots and lots of special stuff with that. So, stuff in there. So, now she's disappeared. What are we going to talk about? What can we say about Carol now she's not here? There you go. So that shows you the two different versions, whether you give it a dust or you don't give it a dust. Let's find your clean piece of paper there. We have some unwanted guests.
I think Barney wants to join
in. I was going to say, we've got some unwanted.
Go on, get out. Go.
Oh, they just want to play. Don't you? Hello, Barney.
Go on.
Yes, hello, Bonnie. Oh, okay. Totally blanked, people. I have been put in my place by a dog. So, right, I'm just going to see whether someone has a coloured marker. But as you can see, that gives you an idea of the different detail you get. I mean, I could have mixed a little bit of dust colour with maybe some alcohol or something.
There's that lovely duck egg blue.
Okay, that's the blue, guys. That's the duck egg blue. And it's stunning. I absolutely love it.
And there's your two moles.
Yeah. It's like Christmas over there.
Yeah.
With the two moles. Do you like the cakes on them though? See?
There's that lilac colour I think you've used today.
Oh, I've used the lilac colour before.
Yeah. And we're down to the pens.
There's the pink. So, as you can see, beautiful, lovely packaging, and it's all there for inspiration, guys.
And
right.
All the pens are back in stock.
All the pens are back in stock, guys.
These are a fine nib. I don't know if you've ever used these, Kerry.
Probably not, actually. So, right, I'm going to come in, and I'm going to just come in and give them a little bit of an eye. The eye will bring them to life. Now, of course, you could spend time and really go to town on these. I'll just give them a little bit of the odd feature around the face.
That's a lovely
just,
colour.
Just enough to bring into life. See, just gives them an eyeball. Those are lovely, that set.
You can have them carry my treat.
Oh!
Because I think you'll enjoy using them. They're all halal. They're all suitable for a halal diet, vegetarians and vegans.
Oh, so I can eat these in the car on the way home?
Yeah, absolutely, of course you can. Nice, good stuff on the pen.
Yeah, I get arrested for that sort of stuff, I'm sure. Okay, so we've done the seahorse. Let's put the seahorse to one side. I think we'll go with... What one do I fancy most? Actually, I don't like him. We'll do this one instead. What the hell was that?
Was that that's a bike.
Oh.
A motorbike, yeah.
I thought one of the dogs had had a problem. Right. Coming back in with my little peace offering here. Right. Where's my drinkless? So.
Here we go.
Yay!
Gwen's been waiting for this big moment. They've sent that many love hearts on the feed.
No, I always intended it to work. As I said, I did learn a very important lesson this week when I was doing it. I picked up dragées, and they weren't all uniform in size. I can't name the product because it would be wrong of me to name the product, but I assumed they were all the same size. They are not all the same size. So I ended up more time unblocking my dragée kiss than I actually did using it. And it wasn't the Drew Ginkiss's fault in the slightest. Turn those other. I'm amazed at how far one of these hoppers goes, Gwen. Mm. So, trick is always let it release all the way to the back. Because if you do that and then you don't give it enough, it won't pop another one out, okay? Just so you know where. Brilliant idea, Gwen. Because I was using a teaspoon to remember this was in the packaging. So, it's always a good idea to keep the pot open. Because if you do find you fired a blank or it's not working, it's easier to fire one into the pot than trying to fire one in your hand and then find out where to put it, okay? So, using a bit of edible glue. So, where's the paintbrush I was using? I've lost it. Oh, there it goes. So, I'm just going to come in. I'm going to put little dots of edible glue into the quilting areas. Now, obviously, if you do all of the quilting area all the way around the cake, by the time you come back to the beginning, it will probably have dried out. So I would say probably do about, if you're doing one of these, do about half, and then you can do the rest. Now, holding it, bit of a press, and it pops it in.
It's a fab tool, isn't it?
It is a fab tool. And obviously doing this onto fresh paste, so it should embed quite easily anyway. If you're a little worried, you could go in, you could go in and press it in further, but to be honest with you, I haven't found I needed to. The trick is being patient to let this come all around. See, that one didn't work, and it's not its fault, it's
my fault.
Do you
know that's the thing, I forget to let it all the way back, because I'm eager to keep pressing like a thing, don't you?
Yeah, and that's the thing.
You've got to let it come back, haven't you?
Yeah, I was thinking, Gwen, can you make a hole there and let it fit my thumb through? But you know it's not going to work, my hand wouldn't fit that. So yeah, quite a clever little gadget you got here, Gwen. Right. I think that's probably about as far as I did it.
Well, she's very pleased that you're sharing the dragée kiss tips.
Oh, are they tips?
Tips, yeah. Well, it's just to remind people how to use it. Because a lot of people, sometimes the pearls are coming out fast and they forget to bring the plunger all the way back. So.
Yeah, and a lot of the time when I had a problem with it, as I said, it wasn't the dragée kiss.
No, it's
usually. Because when I looked at it and I had... The dragées weren't round, they were kidney shaped.
Yeah.
Well, they were too stuck together.
Yeah.
So don't buy cheap dragées, that's what I found. So, what colours did the dragées come in?
They come in various colours. I've only got four colours, but I will tell you that the PME pearls are perfect for it.
Are they? Okay.
Yeah.
Because that's another thing, don't be buying dragées on the internet, because you'll get such a mixed batch.
Yeah. To be fair, we've tried all other popular brands, and they've been a bit messy.
See, it does work. It's just, I think it's the angle I'm at. I'm trying not to hit the border above. Sorry, Gwen, this was going in by hand because I'm trying to save my border. If it was dry, I wouldn't worry, but I don't want to knock it with this. Yeah,
they're all loving it.
Before this, I was one of the tweezer people.
Yeah, well, that's all they want, wasn't it,
yeah.
To be fair. Until you use this, you don't know, do you?
No. Now, if you could just make one, Gwen, that does 1 millimetre dragée, I'd be very happy, thank you very much.
Yeah.
Just doing the 1 millimetre ones, did my head in. I think I'm almost there. There's that me again? That was me again. There you go. I'm scared of damaging a border. Right, I think I've got them all in. There's one just down there. And just nudge that in with the paintbrush. So, as you can see, the addition of pearls isn't actually 100% necessary, but it really does bring it to life. And as you saw with one of the samples I did, I mean, that's a really subtle look.
I have to say, that looks like a satin pillow.
But that.
Yeah.
And again, that's the diamond, but turn it 45 degrees and you've got squares.
Yeah.
So, and I like the drawing.
Yeah.
You wait till pumpkin time comes around.
Yeah.
I've got some serious Halloween issues going to be sorted out with that. So let's just grab a bottle of this. So as you can see, that's your basic.
Mm, fabulous. That really looks like a proper princess cushion, doesn't it?
Mm. So
yeah,
that's
really very
let's
nice.
Let's move that to one side. Let's bring these in. Now, I've actually cheated with the next bit. I've bought some sprinkles, or I don't know what you call these actually, that are already made. However, if I was doing this real, I'd just roll little balls of paste and then luster dust them.
You could
use up the end of it. I'm just being lazy because I was like, you know, it's only Carol, what does she care?
Yeah,
what do I know? So let's just bring a few of the elements in that I was going to use. I've lost my planks of wood. Oh, there they are. Planks of wood. So it's a bit like a shopping trolley. I can just pull out whatever I want from here. So this is where the magic happens. Now, when you're going to do something that is just freehand, just believe in yourself. Just do it. So I'm sure it's a small size piping tip. But use a smaller piping tip. I'm using a number 3 or a number 4 here, I think.
You know, when you made up your Royal Icing Mixer, the instant one?
Yes.
How long will that last for?
I want to say the packaging says you can keep it for 7 days.
Right.
I want to say in this weather, just make sure it's in the fridge. I don't normally refrigerate Royal Icing. However, with this heat, you've got raw egg. Just be very careful of it.
Yeah.
Normally, you just keep it in a cool room. You can put it in the fridge. Just let it come up to room temperature overnight in the morning before you go ahead and use it. So, where's my hand? So I'm going to take my Mr. Seahorse, put a little bit of raw icing on the back of him, just so he stays in one place. And he can come. I'll turn this back to you at each stage, guys, don't worry. So, just sit him in the middle there. Then I'm going to work my way around the cake. Now, I'm not going to do the whole cake because obviously we don't need to be here for hours and hours and hours. But I am going to put in some of these elements just to show you that I can quickly, very quickly turn this into a complete different look just by anchoring pieces down.
They're like little mini gobstoppers, aren't they?
Yeah, there's a name for them and I can't remember what they're called. I know they're very popular in the States. I can't remember what they're called though. Yeah, these things will do yourself an injury.
Do they call them gumballs or something?
No. Are they called sixlets or something? I think they might be called sixlets. Anyone out in America there?
We've got Donna Ryan, so Donna Ryan might know.
Donna, are these sixlets? I've got a feeling this excellent. Let's do a smaller piece up here. So now I'm just adding bits of wood purely just for a little bit of interest, where it looks a bit too sugary sweet. So I have to turn it around just so I can.
Yeah, they are called sixlets. Thanks, Donna.
There you go. I had a feeling they were called sixlets.
That's what happens when we have our American friends join us.
Full of information, Donna. Full of information.
Donna's been a very good customer with us for a while now. I knew she'd be there for shout out. Yeah, and Michelle Ahern, she's from America as well. Sixlets, yeah.
Yeah, I thought I'd.
April says they're called balls.
Okay, April, you've just lowered the tone, lovey. Really?
Well, I think you started once she said you were going to run round in your boxes.
I think Maria started it when she started stripping off in the corner. Really, I can't be blamed for everything.
Zoe says they're shiny balls.
Just getting worse now.
It is getting worse. We're not going to talk about this anymore, people. There may be children watching.
It's after nine now, we don't care. Oh, yep, Nikki says there's sixlets candy by Sweetworks.
Oh, are they? Okay, so you know
even
more.
So you're in the America, if you're in America, you know what you're getting.
So, and a couple of them to here. So
otherwise, you'll have to make your own.
Well, and the reason you have to do, just really roll them into little balls, let them dry, put them in a pot with some luster dust, shake the luster dust pot around, and you'll have exactly the same thing. Right, so that's the basis for it. I'm just going to come in and now go to town on the sea theme. So. Now, obviously, I'm not taking a lot of care with this, whereas you could easily take a lot more time and plan, but then you don't have hundreds of people watching you. So. Or do you? But this is the joy of having quality pre-moulded pieces. They're already done for you. You've got them in a box, you've let them dry, and then a little project comes through, you can just take them out and go, right, well, add those to that, that to that. So, let's do. Hopefully this will stick and not slide down the side of the cake. You better stay there, okay, kid. Right. Yeah, these stones, I've actually done them in the same colour as the wood, the driftwood for this cake, but they look great if you do them marbled in different shades of grey.
They,
they really do look great when you do that. So, a little, let's go for a different colour. One more on the other side. Let me have a quick look. Right. Sorry, guys, you're not seeing a lot of this.
No,
on
we are.
No, we can see everything.
Right over your shoulder.
Yeah. No, we can see everything.
Oh, that's me thinking I was getting away with it. So. It's just one of these cakes that just takes shape.
The mould for the words, Samantha, is dreams.
You can't remember. Dreams.
Dreams.
Life, driftwood, or something.
Yeah, I think it's dreams, driftwood, and words, isn't it? Or something.
See, it's not
me. Find it under Katie's.
I did the link before.
No, she posted it.
I did post the link before.
It's out there somewhere. Yeah, see, it's not just me. I can't remember it ever. And I love the mould, I just can't remember what it's called. I think I just need maybe something down there. Or do I? that'll pretty much do it, guys. Gorgeous. I mean, you can be adding and adding and adding. Believe me, know when to stop. Because
yes,
that's my problem. I'll just add and add and add. So.
That looks absolutely stunning.
So.
Absolutely stunning. I would never have thought about putting all that together. It looks great.
But the thing is, it's just, and nearly everything on there is pre-made or pre-moulded or pre-bought. So it doesn't take much to make a wow cake.
No.
Now, you could have seen it, as I said, you could have painted that silver, you could have painted it
I've got
gold.
The name for that. It's Dream Driftwood and Word Stones.
Dream Driftwood and Word Stones.
Yeah, I knew it was a mouthful.
Really, really handy. I know we're labouring this, but you know what? Just take a cookie, stick a word on it. It's as easy as that, do you know what I mean? Why don't you do all the cookies with different words on,
yes.
Have them upside down on a table and play a game? You
yes.
come in and you pick up the cookie and you have to say or act as to what you've got on the
yeah.
other side. So, see what I mean?
They've got love, dream, laugh and something else, haven't they?
Driftwood.
That is very, very pretty. Very pretty. So, guys, what do we think? Oh, look at all those love hearts coming.
Yay!
Plenty of them there. So, are you done now, Kerry?
I'm done with this cake.
Yeah.
I just want to make sure.
We can get all three cakes on.
Yes, we can go over a cube, you can go over a rectangle, you can go over a square. That's what I was going to show you. Stop a second. I've got to show you the trick for going over the corner of something.
Oh, yeah, you told me to remind
yeah.
you.
Yeah, was Carol supposed to remind you that one?
Sorry.
Right, let me just pop you back here a second. I only need to do a little edge of the paste anyway. I don't have to do the whole thing to show it to you. So this would work with the mini or the large one, but I should imagine the mini I'd only be doing on things like jewellery boxes. Alright, let's grab just a little bit of paste. Right. So pretend we've moulded the whole thing, guys. I'm just going to mould this little tiny bit just so I can show you, because I neglected to show you. So. You don't like bags, do you? I can tell. So, right. So, let's just pretend this is perfect, which we know it's not. So, if I was putting this onto something square, is this which one's the best one to point it to?
Right here, perfect.
This one?
Yeah.
Right, if I'm attaching it and going around the corner of a square, you need to make sure that this line is the corner of the square, because when it goes onto the cake, these two need to join over the top. Can I have something square?
Oh, yeah. I can empty this box. Do you want me to empty this box?
Or just take the lid off this and I'll turn the box upside down.
Yeah.
Oh, problem.
Okay.
No, these are all the colours, guys. So if you can still see this, so. Can you see this corner
yeah,
here?
Yeah, it's fine, yeah.
Right. So I would take this line it up, and then these fold over the top.
Oh, that's
wow.
clever.
Do you see what I mean?
Oh,
then
that's clever.
This square bit here matches this bit here. So then that slots into that square.
That's
okay,
clever.
So that's how it happens. So, and then all of the others, of course, link over the top
yeah.
as well. And that's how I did the square. Okay,
absolutely
and it slots in. So that was the secret to that one that
yeah.
I found out. So sorry that was a bit haddash, but you know what? That's the way
it was. Well worth it to be there.
Just to
absolutely.
So anyway, so we have the big cake, which is the project for the night, which is that one. This was the one, as I said, that has the square that goes around the corners. And then the last one is the handbag cake. And as you can see, these were made a dream by the Dridikas. Thank you, Gwen. You're a star for inventing that one, I can tell you, girl. Because otherwise the tweezers would have sent me insane. So, this was just sprayed a little to give it a bit of a sheen, because I wanted to give it like a satiny type look. It ended up, I think, a bit like a plastic bath bag. But I think I went over the top of the luster spray.
I was going to say, the machine's really shiny.
It's really, really shiny. The bigger. I'd like to have put a handle on it, but in honesty, I just ran out of time. But it would look great with a handle, or maybe a set of pearls or a glove over the top. But just know that just a simple idea. And because it's going around a gentle curve, it hasn't got a problem. It's as if I was coming up over the top of here, it does. Because when you go to the centre, the dimensions of a grid change, and I couldn't get that into the mould. It just didn't work. So, and to be honest with you, if I was going around a complete wedding cake, I've only got this much of a cake to deal with anyway. I could come around there to the base of the next tier and start again. So I could effectively do a complete quilted wedding cake.
Yeah.
Okay? I just haven't had a chance to do it. It's only been launched 7 days ago.
7 days, yes.
I'm still playing with it myself. So, hopefully, Carol, that was fun.
Absolutely fantastic, Kerry. Thank you very much.
I destroyed your kitchen.
Yes,
but that's normal, isn't it?
Absolutely. Yeah. So, guys, you've been absolutely fantastic tonight. You have been giving Kerry lots of loves, lots of thumbs up. He totally deserves it. It's a fantastic mould. We were very fortunate that we were the first one to be able to release it. When Kerry released it last week, we were given permission to release it straight after him, which we did. Yep. Took full advantage of that. So lots of our customers bought it immediately. I have done a little tiny discount if you buy them individually. There's a £2 discount if you buy the two together. They're on the wish list. Grab this mould. It is an absolute beauty. You can go back over this live. Maria's took loads of little videos that she'll be doing this week. She'll be making those up for you, so you'll be wanting this mould. It's beautiful. And Kerry, I know you've sat on the motorway for 7 hours, but thank you very much for joining us. And he's actually going to drive back home tonight. He doesn't want to face it all again tomorrow.
Yeah,
so that's one hell of a day this man's put himself through, there and back, home again, and doing this demo. So massive big round of applause. Please show your appreciation. Do buy his mould. It's an absolute beauty. And all the other little bits we sell on our website. We actually sell everything that Kerry's shown you tonight, apart from the cichlids. We don't sell those.
Yep, and if I'd have had time, I would have rolled them.
But I know, you
seriously,
weren't going to, weren't you?
I'm like, that's not happening.
Yeah.
Yep.
So thank you. So please like and share. This will be on YouTube tomorrow, okay? Do like and share the post. And we are going to be back on Thursday morning with Laura. Laura, not this Laura.
She's going, no.
Laura's
no.
going to save herself right up to the day of signing her second year contract. So, Laura, love. So, Laura, my daughter Laura is going to be in showing you how to make marshmallows. She's going to two-tone them. She's going to make them the normal way, and she's also going to make them suitable. Well, she's going to have a go at making them with the, go on Laura, what's the cover called?
Agar gel.
Okay.
Oh, look at you, you said it nice, didn't you?
I'm a baker, we use it.
I went agar.
Agar, agar. It's agar. Or it depends what country you're in, I suppose, we're missing.
So anyhow, she's going to try making them with those to see if they're successful. And then on Monday night, we've got Claire Corbett here, who is making cake pops. Now, I'm not in the kitchen on Monday, so you will see Laura, and I will be watching her. She's hosting on Monday, so she's got to get in front of the camera and host and help Claire out. So Claire will be here doing cake pops. The following Thursday, we've got the other Laura here making fudge. And then on the Monday after that, we have Jerry in with cake lace. So she'll be making cake lace, so we're excited about that. And then at the last day of the month, we've got Dawn Butler in with her brand new airbrushing machine. So that's the whole of July sorted out.
And do watch Dawn, that's a very clever machine.
Yes.
I've seen a bit of a preview of it. Yeah,
it's looking good, isn't it?
Yeah,
I've seen it, it's looking good.
Yeah.
She's got some amazing colours as well.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Yes, Dawn, you and I need to talk.
Yes, so. Absolutely. So, make sure you keep your diaries open for the whole of July. We are fully booked with guests for August. We're fully booked for September, I think, aren't we? I think we've got an odd slot left for September, and then we're into October before we're going to start mithering again.
You'll be at the NEC before you know it.
Exactly. So thank you very much, guys. Everything's on the wish list. Go and have a look. If there's anything you want to talk to me about, just private message me and I'll sort it out for you. But otherwise, good night. Thank you for joining us.
Bye, guys.
Bye-bye from Kerry,
thank you.
Laura and Maria.
Bye.
Bye.